Thanks, everybody, for that excitement. I'm telling you, I know it's hard to kind of roll out in the end of a long day. So I really appreciate everybody sticking around. And I'm hoping to make this a very memorable speech. And I've got a lot of good stuff to show you, but I also have a surprise right there. We're going to keep it hidden a little bit. But in the middle of our talk, I'm going to give you a little bit of a live demonstration. Now, I got to forewarn you all, I'm either the bravest or the dumbest when trying to do live demos. As you probably know, you could train and practice 30 times on this stage with everything perfect. Then the 31st time will not work. So we'll give it a shot. I have a lot of confidence in this, and I really want to drive my point home today. So when I was thinking about this talk and what I should really try and push forward here, I'm always looking way far ahead. I'm not looking 1, 2, 3 years, even sometimes 5 years. I'm looking 5, 7, 10 years ahead, because we all know how long it takes for us to figure out what to do to solve the problem, much less to develop it and build it. So even though the cloud is doing amazing things in terms of creating a lot of opportunity to secure your infrastructure, it really is still a challenge to build in that capability. So I was thinking about it, and I developed the deck, and this past weekend I'm sitting there kind of thumbing through the channels, and I don't know if you have kids, I have two little boys, and they're into this Xbox game called Skyrim. Does any of you know about this thing? It's kind of cool, right? It's actually really cool. The graphics are amazing on it, and it's really cool because the character, it's a role-playing game, and the character walks through this world, basically, right? And it goes from village to village and takes on certain adventures and challenges. And they go in and out of these hamlets, et cetera. And I was kind of scrolling through the channel guide, and I saw Robin Hood, the movie, right? You remember this, 2010, Russell Crowe. And I started to watch it. I'm like, wait, this is cool. This is Skyrim. Like, all the scenes going into these tiny little towns, et cetera. I thought to myself, okay, well, I gotta seem like a cool dad, right? So I'm gonna watch this movie, be able to relate, maybe bring the kids in and show them how cool dad is. Well, about probably two-thirds, three-quarters of the way through, there was a pretty dramatic scene. Now, Robin Hood, Russell Crowe, his character, he was basically abandoned by his father when he was 6, and he doesn't remember much of that. But what he does finally come to remember through the story is one phrase in particular. And this one really took hold of me. And it goes something like this: rise and rise again until lambs become lions. Now, in the movie, they ask him, well, what does that mean? Once he realizes and remembers that phrase. And he says, it means never give up. Now, of course, I teach this to my boys at every possible turn. So I'm like thinking, oh, this is the coolest movie ever. Finally validates everything I'm telling them, right? And so I'm thinking about it, and I'm like, you know what? It actually means a lot more than that. And I think what it really means is that the lion in the scene and in the movie, of course, is the king, okay, and royalty. And they control the liberties of the people. Okay, the lambs. So the message really here is that the lambs can become lions if we simply rise and rise again and never give up and take control of our own liberties to control our own future. That's what I want to talk about here today. So we all know we've been in this business a long time, most likely, and we all know that being on the good side is really, really hard. It's not easy. In fact, being the bad guy is far more easier, I guess, better English. Far more trivial, because all you have to do is find one little crack in one portion of a dam to break the whole thing open. And that is just, quite frankly, not fair. I mean, to the point where I get approached probably every week by somebody, a longtime friend, that just says, man, I'm exhausted. I can't do this anymore. I heard that they're paying like $500,000 for an ESX vulnerability. I'm going to go after that. I'm going to find that. No, 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 no. Please don't. Never give up. We don't have to give up. And I'll talk about why. So you've seen this theme for the show, probably, right? The great cipher. So about 400 years ago, believe it or not, there were two religious factions fighting. I know that never happens, but there was. In France, the Royal Catholic Army fighting the Protestants, otherwise known as the Huguenots, right? And the Huguenots were short on supplies, so they sent out an encrypted message, which of course was captured and then deciphered. And it basically said, hey, I need more supplies. They sent it back decrypted. Huguenots said, we're pretty much got to give up, and they did. Now, of course, the French Catholic army there was, Rossignol was tasked to go about and create the uncrackable cipher, right? And they did, and for 200 years or so, it stood the test of time until that key was lost and then recracked a little while later. And my main message and my takeaway from this story, it's actually a great story and a great theme for what we want to talk about today, is that, you know, number one, ciphers, or really any form of communication, if it's not done securely, can mean the life, or mean the difference between life and death. They saw that then, we see it here today. The second is nothing is unbreakable, as we've learned that. In fact, that's the worst thing that we can do is say it's unbreakable, because it'll probably be broken 10 times faster than if we just shut up, right? And not said a bloody thing. All right, so 2011, man, that was a boring year. Not really. This was a mess, quite frankly. We track this stuff, of course. We're very close to the incident handling and the issues that occur and the core vulnerabilities that occur, of course. But I think this was the age and the year of really deflowering some organizations that really didn't think that they would ever be pulled into this world of security and hacking and hacktivism. Entertainment companies that sat there and said, who would want to hack us? I mean, we make people laugh. We make movies and songs and cool stuff. Like, why would you want to hack us? And, you know, honestly, it doesn't always follow any rhyme or reason, and all it takes is one little trigger. And you've seen the others all the way across. So it's a big challenge that is only getting worse and worse every year. Now, the history of this and the evolution, if you will, has been really started with ego. You know, the bad guys wanted to prove that they were smarter than you, that they were going to rub your little noses in it. But then they started to figure out, hey, we can actually make money, a lot of money, tons of money. So financially driven attacks occurred. Then someone said, hey, well, wait a second, we can actually spy on our enemies. So espionage, the world of espionage with Ghostnet and others. Then, 2008, right, around the Stuxnet time, weaponry. Being able to use vulnerabilities and threats to actually create damage in the physical world. This was a new concept. Even though we had been talking about it for a long time, we hadn't seen it in the public domain. And then, with 2010, the rise, really, of hacktivism, we saw the panel, and purpose, or perceived purpose, to really where we're going in the future. All right, so I'm a victim of La La Land. I live down in Southern California. So you might ask, well, what does Hollywood have to do with anything around security, right? Well, you'd be actually surprised. Hollywood has been predicting hacker themes, hacker techniques, hacker attacks for a long, long time. Far longer than I actually ever knew when I started to look into this. But I don't know, you probably remember Star Wars, right? R2-D2 hacking up the trash compactor, saving the day. Remember that? The computer attacking the computer. I mean, that is cool. And that was a long time ago, right? You have the Wrath of Khan, one of the first representations of using, basically they hacked into the other ship's computer to lower the shields, okay, to destroy them. Remember, a lot of what we've seen in the past 10 to 15 years was out there long before in Hollywood, okay? In fact, the first one, has anybody seen this movie, by the way? Just curious. 1968, Hot Millions. the first movie really of its kind that we've been able to track. And it did so much. It actually included a number of different techniques. So he's a con man, just gets out of jail, actually an accountant that is doing the warden's taxes. And he decides, hey, I figured out a way to make millions. So he takes on the identity of a computer programmer at an insurance company, goes in, changes the computer program to start siphoning and skimming off millions and millions of dollars. And then, of course, runs away in bliss, happily ever after. And there's been others. Well, of course, right? This one really started it all for a lot of us, and snubbed by the Oscars, quite frankly. Horrible, horrible travesty. Brilliant movie. Being able, and this was one of the first as well, to introduce the concept of a computer, a virtual world, controlling the physical world, right? Enemy of the State, if you weren't paranoid before you watched that, you were absolutely paranoid. It was insanely vexing around how they got all of that intelligence very quickly. And then, of course, even just up until this past year, in the end of this year, with the girl with the dragon tattoo, basically spying on their targets. All right, so we've seen Hollywood be a pretty good predictor, okay? And I think it's in large part due to the fact that they've been victims themselves, right? Have you seen and heard about all of these stars? So first, Paris Hilton. All of the News of the World folks, and then of course this hackerazzi. So with Paris Hilton, it was easy. How did they get in? Does anybody remember? The dog's name, right? What was the dog's name? Tinkerbell. Okay, very, very simple. There's no complexity whatsoever. You think that, gosh, the bad guys really are super, super smart. Not all the time. They don't have to be. Hugh Grant, the whole News of the World scandal, hiring a private investigator to go after voicemails, right? To log in, brute force the PIN, do a caller ID spoof to log in and listen to their voicemails. All the way to the hackerazzi operation. It actually, I call it the Google Razzi attack, because while the attacker and the big headline was, hey, all these celebrities' phones got hacked, it was actually because a particular hacker just guessed their Gmail passwords. No two-factor, guessed their passwords, got in, of course everything was synced, started to pull pictures back, contacts back, and email. So the scriptwriters for Hollywood, we can learn from them, right? But what are the core ingredients to this so that we can try and predict going forward? The first one really is opportunity. And this comes in two forms. The number of devices, right? The opportunity to go hack, as well as the vulnerabilities that are present. And I don't mean just like Microsoft vulnerabilities or Apple vulnerabilities. I mean anything that puts the asset in a vulnerable state. That could be an easily guessed password, it could be a misconfiguration, it could be the ability to escalate privilege, right? So those are all the opportunities. And this, as we've seen all the numbers, and I'm not gonna repeat them all, this is going nuts, and it will. So by the end of the decade, we'll be skyrocketing in terms of number of devices that need to be managed. The second ingredient is motivation, for sure, and it could be financial or it could be hacktivism, it doesn't really matter, and that, of course, is strong. And then lastly, it's ability. And there's no trailing of ability at this point. Bad guys are getting smarter, we're getting smarter to prevent them, and putting it into technology as best we can. So the combination of these three really is what drives the stories. And then there's a threat taxonomy that you can think of, right? There's actors, there's sources, where they're actually coming from. There's motivations we talked about. Why are they doing what they're doing? There's the specific targets. They're going after different stuff now. It's not the age-old, hey, we just go hack a Windows box or go hack an Apple or even a mainframe. They're going after the small embedded stuff now, a rainbow of flavors and colors. And then the techniques. Now, again, not just vulnerabilities, but going after features, quite frankly, right? Features, not bugs, that allow them to gain access in. All right, and we've been evolving quite a bit here from the mainframe world, which I started and or started to get involved in security in IT. I did not start mainframes, by the way. I'm not that old. And all the way going towards really Windows and Apple, Linux, of course, with embedded Linux and things like that, real-time operating systems, all the way now to this embedded world. And it's this embedded world that I want to really focus on and talk about, because it's an invisible world that we don't get to see all the time. And we think that because it's contained and controlled, that it cannot be hacked. It is secure by design. And I want to challenge your thinking on that. And the stakes are high if we don't. If we don't look at this today, remember, these manufacturers take years, years and years and years to fix these things. These are not something that you can just push from the cloud and update. It's not going to happen, at least not for a while. So we need to think about this world equally alongside the desktops, the devices. All right, so let's play a little game. Let's name this condition. 438 million people are affected by, or will be affected by this in 2030. 6.4% of the population, 285 million worldwide today, seventh largest killer in the US, and about 200 or so in this room. Diabetes. Now, those that are afflicted by diabetes, there's really two types, okay? There's a type one, which really affects the pancreas's ability to produce insulin and put it into the blood. The second affects the actual cells of the body so that it cannot uptake on insulin and turn the sugars into energy, okay? In both cases, the solution is insulin, okay? But often it requires needles, historically, to inject. But now we have these wealth of devices that allow for the distribution of that insulin automatically into the body, and many or most of these are controlled by wireless. Okay? So we know that these devices exist, that they are on people all the time, and yet we probably don't even think about it, right? It's just a natural part or extension of us. So let me talk about what this kind of technology exposes us to. All right, now you know, if you've seen ever my talks, I usually try to bring in a demo. I really do believe that a picture is worth a thousand, but a demo is worth a million. So let's try and get this thing started. All right, so. Hopefully we'll switch it up. Get my screen up there somehow. So I'm running my little laptop right up here, and we have a pump, an infusion pump, sitting on the desk. We're going to show in just a second. And I also have an antenna. Now, this is just a little guy. This is a high gain 900 megahertz antenna. Okay, it's just a little guy. This is so I can get through the airports and not get fully body cavity searched, right? I tried once with the big one, it wasn't going. So this works out really well, this little guy, okay? It's connected to an adapter, and it's this adapter that allows me to plug into USB, okay? Simple little adapter. We're gonna put this down. And the pump is sitting on the counter here. So why don't we switch to that? Now, in the middle screen, hopefully y'all can see this. This is the application that we wrote to demonstrate this vulnerability. So what I'm going to do is, first of all, I'm going to use it to scan for my pump. So as you can see, it's basically sending out a packet, waiting for this particular device to receive it and send it back. Okay, it's associated, it found the ID, So I'm just going to stop the scan. Okay. Here's our pump, 482275. Now, you might think, okay, this is cool, but why not just turn off the wireless? There's actually a feature in the menu. You can turn it off. Well, it actually doesn't turn it off. It puts it into low power mode. So all we do is we tell it to go into high power mode. We send a little packet, it wakes it up, and turns it on full. So the second thing that we can do is we can populate the fields in our little table here with the data inside the pump. So we can learn the firmware, the pump model, the max bolus, the remaining insulin, et cetera. So here we go. You can see it up here, retrieving firmware, pump model, and it'll cycle through. Now, max bolus is, of course, the maximum amount of units that can come out at one time. And this is the remaining insulin, 44 units. So now, what we can do is a couple other things. We can suspend the pump, we can resume the pump, or we can dump all the insulin from this pump. That's what I want to show you right now. All right, so you'll see on the side screens the pump itself. Now I want you to watch two things as you're watching this demo. The screen at first, then you'll see at the tip of that tube, hopefully, demo gauze are on us, coming out with insulin. Now I've colored the insulin, it's really water, colored the water blue to give you a sense of it coming out. And it takes just a few seconds after I hit dump insulin. Now we of course safety first. I have triplicate controls here. Okay, restricted command, we have to actually punch in the pump ID. We hit enter, sending the command could result in serious injury or death. Are you sure you want to continue? Yes, I do. All right. So we're attempting the association, okay, with the pump. Sending out the data. There we go. Checking if the bolus is active or pump is suspended. If it's suspended, we actually resume it. Okay, bring it back to life. We check the max bolus. Okay, there we go. Boom. You see it? Ticking up. 0.1, 0.2. Now look at the tip. Now insulin disbursement and dispensing takes, it's slow, very slow. It's a controlled medical drug, right? That goes into your body. Okay, you see it? See it drip? It's actually probably easier to see it like that. Okay, there we go. So as you can see now, with this vulnerability, we can control this device, okay, and affect a patient's health dramatically. All right, let's switch back. So is the silence scared? You're either scared to death or stunned by my brilliance. I can't quite figure it out. No, it was not my, I did not find this vulnerability. One of my team did, Barnaby Jack, amazing, amazing researcher. He did all the ATM hacking stuff. And the team that I run internally looks at emerging threats like this every single day. And then works with manufacturers, works with our solution providers internally to see what can we do to help. All right. So let's talk about how can we secure the unsecurable? I mean, many people think, hey, this is out of our range, man. We can't fix this stuff. This is unsecurable, and I have to disagree. But to do this, we've got to change some fundamental thinking, okay? First of all, if you think about our history, this is really it. This is blacklisting. This is responding to threats after somebody's gotten hit, right? It's getting a new sample, a new piece of malware, writing a signature for it, pushing it out in DATS, having you protected. We've got to get away from that mindset. It still has to be a part of it, but it can't be the primary. We have to move to more of a whitelisting and really a gray listing analysis. Looking at, okay, is it bad? No. Is it white? Good, yep, okay, so we let it run. If not, we need to understand it and analyze it in the cloud in real time as best we can. So we gotta think about the problem and the solution differently. The other thing we have to do, which we don't do enough of, is we really have to think about the diagnostic power of what we do. So we have, when you're sick, your kids are sick, you have a family history of something, you're gonna go into the doctor. Why? Because you wanna get some diagnostic input. What do I need to do to prevent this bad stuff from happening or having somebody get worse or have them get better? So you go to the doctor. Doctor's a trusted advisor. You say, okay, doc, what's the deal? Well, the first thing they're gonna do, almost in every case, not just because you can bill insurance, but because they wanna know what is truly wrong with you, they're gonna take tests. They're gonna do tests on you. CT scans, x-rays, MRIs, blood tests, you name it. That gives them all the data that they can make an educated, practiced analysis of what's wrong with you, right? And we need to do this along with providing the pills. The pills are great. We all want to just pop a pill and have everything perfect, but we know that that's not the case, that it never works that way. And this combination of diagnostic and protective really have to work in harmony. Because at the end of the day, what the doctor really wants to say is, hey, you know, I don't want to prescribe you a single pill. Just work out every day, you know, exercise, eat right, eat fruits, vegetables, et cetera, and you will avoid a lot of those problems that you're worried about. But that's good hygiene. That's hard for us to do, right? It's much easier for us to be reactive, to get hit, then go try and figure out how to fix it. And we have to change that way of thinking. So what we really believe in, 100%, I do very strongly, is that we have to push the protective and diagnostic all the way down the stack. So we traditionally sit at the operating system, at the application layer, even at the virtual, but the threats are moving down deeper and deeper. Mebromi, which was the first in the wild BIOS rootkit, was released last year in September. That took advantage, actually overwrote BIOS with its own BIOS so that it could control how it gets reinfected. So we have to think and push these features deeper and deeper down into the firmware, the BIOS, and into the silicon itself where appropriate. And this hardware-assisted security at this point really comes in these kinds of flavors. So the ability to manage that asset, the ability to confirm the integrity, let's say, of BIOS or of firmware, being able to have a trusted BIOS, for example, confirming identity that the person that's actually on the keyboard is the person who owns the device, privacy, right, being able to protect the data that's on there and only allow those that are authorized to see it to see it, and then lastly, when something does go bad and systems do get infected, that we can return them to original states. Okay, but to know the future, let's take a little bit of a look on the past here. When it comes to hardware and features within hardware to help protect us, in the 1970s, when this all kind of started, late 70s, around the desktop, it really was the Wild West. I mean, there was no separation between OS and application. Whatever ran could control the OS, and that's it, right? You had a DOS prompt, and you're done. In the 1980s, we came across this new capability within Motorola and Intel chips called protected mode. Now, this finally separated a bit the OS from the application. So you had to have privilege. You had to get into protected mode to perform the bad stuff. Otherwise, it would be blocked. Next really came execution control, 92 to 2005. Everybody started to figure out, hey, wait a second, we can control what happens in memory, what gets executed in memory. We can control that with a bit, NX bit, XD bit, XN bit with ARM. But today, what really helps provide security around and control of what we're talking about is virtualization. And we've seen those features and capabilities that were once software only now move directly into the core architectures of chips, right? All across the board, whether it be Intel, AMD, ARM, you name it, right? They all have those capabilities, some more than others. But our future, and really virtualization being that stepping stone, is isolation. So not just virtualizing the app or the process or the thread, but actually isolating it 100% from the other threads and processes and apps, okay? And that is really the future. Control is the name of the game, being able to control privilege based on a confirmed identity, the ability to control execution, to control whether a bad piece of software runs and infects, and control of recovery, being able to pull that back. So this mindset of the blacklist, we really have to move it from, instead of preventing the bad stuff, we've got to only enable and allow the good stuff. So let me leave you with these thoughts. I'm the Hack and Expose guy, so everybody always asks me this, like, what do you see are the upcoming threats for the next 3 to 5 years, 3 to 7 years? Let me walk you through this real quick. First of all, this concept of who wants to hack us is pretty much over. You know, this everybody can get hacked. Everybody. Everyone in this room. All the companies, all of our companies can absolutely be hit. There's nothing necessarily that stops that. It's just an issue of when, not if, right? So it's a game, and it's a marathon. It's not a sprint race. Second is this rise again of botnets is huge right now, and utilizing botnets through the botnets using DDoS to attack the target, and that's only going to grow. Social networking and media, this is the megaphone of megaphones. You think networking kind of started the whole malware and virus hunt? No, this is going to do it. This is going to allow it. In fact, I just heard about American Express using Facebook to make payments, right? Very interesting stuff. Whenever I hear that, I think, oh no, I'm gonna be busy. All right, embedded. This is I've hopefully made my point on embedded. Hopefully given you a little bit of insight and visibility into that world. Everybody wants you to forget about it. Trust me, we cannot forget about it as an industry or as individuals. There's too much at stake. Mobile and virtual currency, bitcoins, when we start to use our mobile devices to pay for everything, to transact that kind of business, we're not mainstream there yet, but when we do, and the currencies become basically are on these devices, this is where you will see the explosion on mobile. And that's coming very soon. I kind of hinted at it before, cyber terrorism, it's a very, very strong possibility. It's one of the only things, by the way, that Hollywood has predicted that we haven't seen. So it's got to be real. Trust landscape, we've seen the likes of VeriSign and Komodo and everybody else getting hacked up, right? The root CAs, or at least intimated. This is a big issue. Okay, our very structure, all the SSL stuff, all of the cert stuff, I mean, that depends on a trusted root, a root of trust around certificates. So if this is compromised, our entire trust system is just toss it out the window. Insider threats is going to be increasing, as always, Wikipedia style. Cloud and virtual, we always talk about cloud being a great enabler and it's going to change the world and cure cancer. Honestly, this is one of my biggest worries. Because if I'm a bad guy, I go straight after this. I don't worry about hacking, you know, a million mobile devices. I just go after hacking up one big old honking database, multi-tenant, that I can just rip and tear every piece of data out of there. Cyber retaliation, this is big. We're starting to see companies actually get started that do only this. At least creating a deterrent for the bad guys to come back. Zero-day attacks, you'll see more of them, tons of them. I just got a new one in my inbox the other day. Regulation is going to be big and increasing, especially globally. I saw this a lot in South Africa. I was there a few weeks ago. And then finally, it's not a question of if, but when. Victimization is inevitable. Incident response and a strong, strong, well-tested program is the number one concern that I have. And I call it a threat and opportunity because by and large, we don't have those. So there you go. a few predictions to kind of think about, hopefully chew on. And really, I tie it back to the original Huguenots. When communications cannot be secured, right, it can lead to death. So thank you very much.